generation, generation, down, down. Would they stand up?
Please stand up, Mary.
The G's are, okay. Very good, thank you. Landmarks and landmark people. Speaking of landmarks.
I think I'm the kid at the table, I'm not sure. Am I older than you?
I'm gonna hit 80 pretty soon.
Well, I'm older than you, you're the kid. Well, let me just say that with my brother's great-grandchildren, home on Hancock in Montague Township. And my grandfather married my grandmother, who was a daughter to Henry and Margaret Sieben, and built a house, a log house, on that same piece of property. How many of you know what I still call the Harry Block log house on Hancock? There's a log house on Hancock. Well, right across the street was the original Sieben farm, my grandmother's father's farm. And Grandma and Grandpa built a log house just like Block's house. But it caught fire in 1910 and burned to the ground, taking the barn and the chicken house and everything with it. So Grandpa decided there wasn't any place to make enough money to build again here, so he moved to Chicago. Took his kids, my father and his two sisters. Dad had gone to school at the school on Post and Hancock, where they sell asparagus. Now he's got that house on the northeast corner was the school that my dad went to when they were on the farm. Anyway, make a long story short, Grandma and Grandpa came back to the farm after Grandpa made enough money to get going again. And then my dad was in a severe accident in Chicago and couldn't work anymore and decided that we were going to move back to the farm. So we moved back to the farm in 1942. But it was like being at home because I had spent every summer that I can remember. And I have pictures showing me, even before I can remember, on the farm with the great-grandmothers staying at their house. So I was in Michigan all summer from my childhood until we moved back. And so it always seemed like that was more of a home than Chicago was. But you can imagine, my dad married a girl who was from Chicago. And although mother had been up in the summertime with great-grandma and grandpa, she knew what the rigors of country living were. But if you can imagine that when my dad could no longer operate, he had a severe skull fracture and was incapacitated for several years, to move from Chicago, where she had running water, central heat, transportation, electricity, to a three-room home that my dad and I built, 24 by 24, with a coal stove in the one room. And there was a small bedroom for my one brother, Don, Wayne was born when we were here. And a larger bedroom for my folks, and then one big room, which was the living room, the dining room, the kitchen, and whatever else. But mother made it. She adjusted. We had a three-holer, and we had carpeting on it. Carpeting. And my grandmother's was even greater than that because she had wallpaper in hers. I'll have to tell you. Maybe I should. Well, I will. Grandpa used to drop a piece of newspaper in the hole before he sat down in the wintertime. Kind of warmed it up a little bit. So I thought I would do that. Well, if you don't get that paper down far enough, when it flares up, it not only warms you, it gets you off the hole, I can tell you. Well, but we didn't get electricity. In fact, we didn't get electricity until 1952. And my folks bought the Rose Farm, which is on the corner of Hancock and Lehman. Not Lehman, Lamus. And that's where they moved to while I was in the service overseas. And the REA came and they said, we're putting lines in, but it'll cost you $100 for the pole to get it to your farm. And my dad says, no, I ain't paying $100. Well, my mother and dad got into quite a discussion about that. But Dad held fast until the farm next to us, or down on south of us, Napier, Mr. Harry Napier came up and he said to my dad, he says, Hank, we decided we want electricity, but I understand you won't pay for the pole on yours. And he says, well, it's $100, my dad said. I ain't paying $100. He says, we're getting along all right. Well, Harry says, I'll tell you what. He says, would you have him put the pole in for $50? My dad says, well, yeah, I expect maybe we'd do that, but they aren't going to cut down on anything. Harry says, that's all right. He says, I'll give you the other 50, because my wife says, we're going to have it. And so they did, and then they got the electricity. But my mother told my dad, why didn't you hold out? He'd have probably given you the other 50. And you wouldn't have to pay any. Well, so after that, she was much happier with everything. I can tell you all kinds of stories about G's, but let me just reminisce a little bit about what I can remember about G's. One other thing about Carl, he was a great guy, and he could add up the stuff as it was being laid out on the table in his head faster than either I or ever could add it up on the adding machine. As it was laid out on there, he just came up with it. It just amazed me how quick he was in doing that sort of thing. Great guy to work for. And as you all know, I ended up with a licensed funeral director primarily because of Carl, because he helped me with my schooling, paying for my schooling. The only thing I argued about him was when I was making 32 cents an hour, he pulled me aside and said, now, he says, you're not going to get your full check. I'm not going to get my full check. It's only a couple of dollars or so. He said, no, he says, I'm holding out 10% and I'm investing it for you. Well, you know, when you're 17 or 18 years old, you don't, well, 16 years old, really, and after that. And he said, no, I'm putting that into Investors Diversified, and that's going to be yours, and it'll grow rapidly, and you'll be happy to do it. Well, I never was until when I came back from the service, I needed some money, and by golly, there it was, and it was all because of Carl. And he didn't talk to me about it, he just told me he's going to do it, you know. Well, you've heard where all the places were. One of them that I used to work at the A&P. Remember where the A&P store was? Bud Kunis was the manager at that time, and Mary Morningstar was the cashier. And I was the stock boy and the vegetable, green goods, taken care of. Yeah, produce, and we had a little misty thing that was over the counter, and you had to make sure that was clean so the mist was nice and kept the vegetables all nice. But Bud Kunis and Mary were, what do I want to say? Adversarial from the beginning when I worked there. And I probably shouldn't say this, but Mary could cuss more than any mule skinner. And Bud Kunis was her equal. And when they got in it on something, the ears of a young boy got very red because they didn't pull any punches, but they were very good when customers were in the store. So, you know, nobody else knew it except when I was over at the counter and doing what I had to do, and I'd hear those two up in the front going at it. I thought, man, oh man, I've never heard anybody talk like that before. But then I used to take my lunch at Lil Ranton's. You remember Lil had a little restaurant there, and I guess it's where Pitkin's got their store, new store now, right? That was, wasn't that Lil's?
Yeah.
And that was a great place to go. But of course, working at G's, the other place I went was Dowker's. And most of you know that we Montague boys kind of had a thing about Whitehall girls, you know, kind of not supposed to cross the bridge, you know, all that kind of stuff. Back then, anyway. But I used to get one heaping big malted when I went in there from a certain gal behind the counter. And one day she threw the counter wiping rag at me, and it hit me, and I thought, doggone, somebody's got to tame that gal. And so I did, and I finally asked her to marry me. She said yes, and we've gone from there. In Montague, what I remember fondly is old Fred Sweet's General Store. Anybody remember Fred Sweet in the General Store? There's somebody way in the back. Fred's General Store was a general store. I mean, it had everything from clothing to food to meat to lamps to fuel oil. My brother Wayne was about 5-6 years old, I think, and winter was coming. He didn't have any long underwear. So Friday nights was a big night in Montague. Friday night, the family went downtown. Mother went shopping over to Sweets. Dad went over to Happy Crawl's for his beer. And us kids all went down to Olson's Barber Shop because the Chamber of Commerce had free movies on the side of the building. Okay. Great night. I mean, it was just great. Well, we went, Mother and Wayne and I were down there, and we went into Sweets because we always had to get some candy to take over to see the show. And she asked Sweet if he had any underwear left for little kid or small kids. Oh, yeah, he says, I'm sure I got some up there. He says, just getting toward winter. So he got up on the ladder and the top shelf and pulled down a box, and by golly, there was a set of long johns, wool. Ma says, I'll take them. They'll fit. That's the right size. Well, we got home, and she says, now I want you to try these on. Well, Wayne pulled them on, and they had feet in them. He said, I ain't wearing these to school. I'm not wearing anything with feet in them. Ma says, but it's just, nope. You know, you had the trap door in them and everything else. Nope, he wasn't going to wear them. He finally talked Grandma into cutting the feet out and hemming them. But he wore them and then itched all winter long, as we all did in those kinds of darn things. Fred's son was our mailman. Fred was the mailman. Bill Sweet was the father. Bill was at the grocery store. Fred was the mailman. Fred used to get to our house, out to the farm, out to our place in the wintertime. And he'd toot the horn two times. Dad would go out and open the barn door, and Fred would pull in and put the chains on his car because we had a hoist in the barn, and he could hook the cup, lift back into his car up and put the chains on to do the rest of his route up into Oceana County. And just as regular as clockwork almost. And I asked him once, I said, why don't you do that downtown before you ever start out? He says, no place to lift it. So those were the kinds of things. Well, Roger put down here some things. Let me see. One of them is, what significant childhood events? Well, as I said, you know, I spent every summer as long back as I can remember hunting and fishing and riding horses and swimming and just doing all the kinds of things that kids did at that time. When I was 14, my grandpa decided it was time for me to learn how to plow, and of course he was still using horse. And if any of you have ever tried to handle a single blade plow behind a Belgian horse, which takes force to get the shoe into the ground, and at 14 I probably weighed 90 pounds, maybe 80 pounds. I was a skinny kid, and I could not keep that damn plow in the ground. Grandpa says, you just aim for that, see that tree down there? Yeah. You just go right for that and you'll plow a beautiful straight furrow. Well, I started out, I plowed a furrow all right. Half of it was a furrow, half of it wasn't a furrow, half of it was on the ground, half of it was stuck into the ground, the horse couldn't even move it. But I learned how to plow. It took me some time to do it, but at that time we didn't have a tractor. Grandpa wouldn't buy a tractor even when they were available. And so family's role in the community, well, as you all know, starting with my father, he was a deputy, special deputy sheriff, and ran the system for both fire and police in Montague, and my brothers and nephews and nieces and sons and everybody been involved. Favorite place in the White Lake area? I guess it would be back on the farm where I planted, in 1947 I planted 2,000 pine trees behind the house, behind the barn. And I guess my favorite place is just walking through there now and just seeing little stubs that I stuck in the ground, beautiful pines that are just straight as a whip and probably could build a very nice log cabin if I wanted to. Favorite people while growing up? Well, I've already mentioned Carl and Everett. Everett was, to me, one of the most gentle, admirable persons that I ever knew. He was the most gracious funeral director, and I worked for a number of them during my career when I was licensed. He was the most gracious funeral director that I have ever met or seen operate. I've never seen anyone else. Many people thought he was different, and he was. But this difference was, I never heard him say a mean word about a person. I never heard him swear. He was just a guy that inspired me to be as good a person as he was. His handling of a funeral, from the very embalming of the body in the embalming area, was always one of graciousness and concern, not only for the people who were mourning, but for the person that we were working on to prepare for the burial. Great guy. And it irks me once in a while when I hear someone criticize him for opening a door. He would always open the door. You couldn't get out of a car in a funeral line without ever running up there making sure that the family's door was open before they got out of the car. And that sort of thing just unfortunately doesn't exist anymore. Who else did I admire? Well, Adolf Anton. Oh, I want to tell you another story about Carl. One day I was in the store, and over on the corner by the bank was a bench. And on that bench was Charlie Ruggles. Who else was over there? Charlie Ruggles was from the insurance. Anyway, there was three or four of the older men, about Carl's age, really, over there. And who was it that came in? I think it was Mr. Nelson from the store across the street came in. Carl was in the front window looking out over to the bank where those guys were sitting. Mr. Nelson says, "Carl, what are you doing? Figuring your income tax for this year?" Carl says, "What are you talking about?" "Well, you're counting those old guys sitting on that bench, aren't you?" Carl got a little upset, but since he and Mr. Nelson were pretty good friends, he kind of chuckled afterward. He says, no, he says, I just was wondering what they're talking about today. But the other thing, I used to always have to count how many bamboo fishing poles were still in the hoop outside the door on a Monday morning, because we never took them in. We had a big hoop on the side of the building, and in there was all the bamboo fishing poles. We didn't lose very many. Once in a while, there'd be a couple of them gone and no dollar left or whatever it was, 50 cents. Adolf Anderson was a guy that I also admired. He was, of course, the president of the Bank in Montague, along with Joe Achebach, who was at that time, I think, president, about the same time as president in Whitehall. I worked at the Parker Dairy. Remember the Parker Dairy out on Whitbeck Road? I worked there, the building is still there. I worked there for 2 years when milking machines first came out. And if you remember, the first milking machines weren't really efficient, so you had to strip the cow after you used the milking machine, and that was a job that I just did not like. I'd rather milk a cow right from the beginning as to just work it toward the end. And we never had cows on the farm. My mother didn't like the way cows smelled. She would not have a cow on the farm. Fortunately, the Mowers, Ed Mowers and his mother, who lived on the northwest corner of Hancock, just across the road from us, he had two Jersey cows, beautiful little Jerseys, and gave great milk, lots of cream. Ed was handicapped from an unfortunate accident. His father whipped him with a buggy whip once as a boy when he did something. He went upstairs and went to bed, and when he came down the next morning, he was paralyzed on the left side. And Ed never married, of course, and walked with a very bad limp. But he and his mother were there. So we would get the milk from them, and we had lots of chickens, and so they would get the chickens and eggs from us. It never cost us a nickel. It was just back and forth. You know, you get the chicken and eggs, and we get the milk and cream. So that's the way it went at those times. Outstanding events in Montague? Well, like in Whitehall, the homecoming was always a big event. I mean, it was a big event. It closed the street down just like we do now. Friday movies, what else?
What about the Franklin House fire?
The Franklin House fire was a big fire. And I was down there all by myself when it first started, because I was on duty that night. And I don't remember who turned the alarm in, but I knew that it was going to go down. There was no question in my mind that it was a goner. And if you see one of the pictures that was taken, you'll see me standing all by myself. There's only one fire truck there at the time, standing in the middle of Ferry and Dowling Street, looking at the hotel as it's burning up. That was a bad, bad situation.
Anybody else have any comment?
Roger, I have been sitting here trying to get courage to tell of the occasion that happened in high school when I was a senior. We had superintendent that everybody didn't like. We didn't like him at all. And this one chap, he decided he was going to fix him. So at Christmas time, he went out and picked up three droppings from a horse and put them in the box. And he put a piece of paper in it with a note on it, wrapped it all up pretty, and put it under the Christmas tree. Of course, the superintendent always opened his gifts at Christmas time. And he opened it up from one horse's ass to another.
Okay. Very good. That takes care of that end of the table, I guess.
stuff on the follow, right?
Looking left over here, Marion, Blanche, okay.
Lots of reminiscence, but gotta be another time.
Okay.
Roger.
Yes.
I might tell them.
Okay, when Marion.
Gustav was my grandfather. Pauline was his sister. She married Barney Ackerman, and they built a farm up where Heartland is now, where I'm residing. So quite ironic.
Okay, then I said also at the end there'd be questions if you'd like to ask specific questions to any one of the members.
I have one thing to say.
Okay.
Henry only told a part of the story.
Oh.
No.
Yeah. His mother planted lilacs all through that woods. I used to visit to her when she was up at the Heartland.
Well, where is that, Henry?
Right on the corner of Lamus and Hancock.
Hancock. Blue House, Gray House.
I'll have to drive along.
Actually, planting hollyhocks in the woods is rather a novel thing. Today, they'd be planting something else.
I missed lilacs.
Won't go there, okay. Other comments? Questions?
Hollyhocks,
what you
put around the outhouse.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. I thought there was myrtle.
No, hollyhocks, because they grew high and
hidden. Actually, you know, if you're out in the country and you're driving along and you do see something like a patch of myrtle or also like lilac bushes, chances are there was an old farmhouse. You know, you see the old trees standing there. And there's always the clues, and any other comments? Yes.
Do we have time for a song?
A song, sure. Who's going to sing it?
Dexter.
Oh,
okay.
I don't know if you remember my first real friend or not, but her name was Flamin' Mamie.
Oh, yes.
They call her Flamin' Mamie. The surefire vamp, the hottest baby in town. She's a heart scorcher, she's a human torture. She's a gal that brings them down. Now of all those dampened turning mamas, not one compares. For she carries fire insurance on everything she wears, which isn't much. And when it comes to loving, she's a human oven, but she's hard to understand. Now it may sound funny, but paper money would burn right in her hand. And the fireman so old that he had to retire said she's the hottest thing he's seen since a Chicago fire. They call her Flamin' Mamie, the surefire babe, the hottest little baby in town. I don't mean maybe, the hottest little baby in town.
Good one, good one. Also, you know, when we talk about the King family, we all remember Junior King, Lee King, and the bands. And I see Mary Lee back there, and you know, they always play down at Murray's. And I think music somehow is in the King family. Definitely. Okay, who else? What else? Jean, do you want to...
Well, just please, if you are through...
I think we are. Are we through?
Yeah. Help yourself to the refreshments that are over there, because there's all kinds of cookies.
I just have one question.
Okay.
I know Henry was a big part of starting the whole pumpkin roll, which of course is coming up again. When did kids actually start rolling pumpkins down that hill?
Before I did.
So a long time ago.
Yeah, that went on a long time because it was something that I partook in too before it was limited.
It was more fun at midnight.
I was one of them that Louis Buttleman used to chase. Louis Buttleman was our constable. And one time He used to park his vehicle down at Ornberger's, which is where a T-car is now, Ornberger's gas station, Shell station. And he was out checking doors, so we got a couple of cement blocks and lifted the rear wheels just off the ground. And then we went up the top of the hill and rolled a bunch of pumpkins down. And he knew we were on the top of the hill, so he got in his car and he put her in gear and went. He didn't go anywhere. So we walked down nonchalantly downtown, gave him a hand to put his car back on the road.
And here was gentler days.
Great story.
Then I ended up being a policeman.
In the early 30s, we started playing at the Jack and Jill Ranch, and we played out there for about 35 years. And the reason I say that is some of the girls out there married fellas from this area. Benny Schultz's wife came from there. And I went to the jazz concert Sunday with my son-in-law over at the Oak Ridge Country Club, and there was two fellas came up and said, "Dexter, I can remember when we used to come out, and before we were married, when we used to come out to Jack and Jill Ranch, we had to get passes to get in to begin with, and if we wanted to date any of the girls, we had to get date passes. We put our license, car license on them and our driver's license, and if there was any hanky-panky, they just tore up our passes and we weren't allowed out there anymore." So,
who's in the picture, Dexter?
There was usually quite a few fellas from this area that came there, because there was 250 guests and about 175 of them were women. So we needed some fellas to come out to dance. And the fellas came from North Muskegon, from Shelby and Hart and Fremont, Whitehall and Montague. And they had a good time out there. But the girls from town didn't like it because their boyfriends were going out there on Tuesdays. We started playing Tuesday, Thursday, and Sunday. And then we ended up playing just Thursday and Sunday for 35 years. But we had a lot of fun out there.
Let me just add to that, during the Second World War, when it was only ladies out at Jack and Jill, practically even probably closer to 100%, they used to send a bus down to White Lake and take us senior high schoolers out there to dance with the girls. But none of my classmates hitched up with any of them. We all ended up here. In fact, our motto for graduation was rowing, not drifting. But out of 32 of us who graduated, I think only three rowed because most of us stayed right here in White Lake.
Okay. I just a comment about Henry talking about the Louis the Law. Our generation called him Louis the Law. The nice thing about Louis the Law was he was always parked down by Banks Delivery Barn or whatever across the street, and so like you knew immediately where the cop was. There was only one, and so you could sort of misbehave elsewhere.
Louis used to get us in as much trouble as he got us out. We'd be down to Green Haven eating, and he said, "You know, so-and-so up there's got a beautiful batch of pumpkins." Then he'd go up and wait for us.
Well, the Whitehall cop, he had a little old hat and a little old coupe and everything, but I'm trying to think of his name, Raleigh Merrick.
He had a white uniform for summers. Remember when the tourists came? He had a white outfit, white hat. Really spiffy in this small town, boy.
What kind of a car would you call that little thing?
With a Chevrolet.
But I mean, it was a two-door little coupe.
Cool.
Thing.
It was a roadster, wasn't it? With a rumble seat.
With a rumble
seat.
Right,
with a rumble seat. We're pretty prisoner.
We didn't take prisoners.
Oh. Whitehall didn't have a job, or a jail. Montague did have a jail in the back of the fire station.
We used to have a jail.
Where was it?
On the old City Hall.
Yeah. We didn't. I never saw the one in Whitehall. It
wasn't as fancy.
Wasn't as good as ours. Ours was bigger. You had more taverns over here, but we had bigger jails over there.
Rody forgot to take, he forgot to take, one night he put a guy in there and he forgot to go through him. And that door, I think, is 8 inches back there in the jail. And when he got there in the morning, that guy darn near carved through that door to get at the latch. He used to take us in there all the time and show us that garbage.
Okay, I any other comments? Thank you for your patience, et cetera. And I'm glad they put this panel together, the Sesquicentennial Committee, because basically there are some good stories. And we shall all should kind of know more about the area, et cetera. I have a kind of old city planning background. I always feel that the more people know about a place, the more they respect it, the more they appreciate it. And that's, to me, that's a great role of the Historical Society, just to keep all the yarns and the stories going and realize that we do live in a very special place. So thank you, and Jean.
Just drive safely and have a cookie.